want to welcome everyone this morning to such a very special event. And the special event is not that I'm the CEO and this is my first political event as CEO. The special event is that we have a good friend, Senator Packwood, with us. And even more special than that is that he brought somebody very special with him. Are you going to introduce her later or can I do that now?
You're talking about me?
Yeah. Are you going to introduce her or do...
I don't know who you're talking about.
Okay. I will introduce her after I'm done with the sponsors, just to make sure that you don't want to recommit yourself to introducing your wife, who he brought today. As you know, we cannot have events like this without sponsorships. And so, Larry Schwartz, would you please stand? Right before you drink, Larry Schwartz of Riverview Bank is one of our key sponsors, our presenting sponsor. And Dean and John Maloney, would you please stand too? PGE, would you give them a round of applause? Without Riverview and Portland General Electric, the event like this would not run as smoothly because we would increase the price to you. That would not be good. And our education sponsors, Athena, would you stand too? Athena with Gresham Barlow School District. Gresham Barlow is the education sponsor. Thank you. Keith, you're doing a great job. We also have a media sponsor for Metro East Community Media. And for thanks for recording this. And you can see this at a later date by going on cable and going, Keith, thank you. And will you please say our thank yous to the folks that you work with? Thank you. I'm pleased that almost the entire City Council of Gresham is here today, and it's not called a quorum, but I would like all of our City Council members from Gresham to please stand, and I'll acknowledge you. Please stand. We have Lori Stegman, thank you. Michael McCormick, Kirk French. I didn't say mayor. Would you sit down, please? Is Jerry here? Would you please congratulate and thank our City Council members for being here? And actually, the mayor did recognize my fupa. You're supposed to introduce the mayor first, and I blew that totally. So now we have to get me out of the hole I have dug myself in all by myself. And please give a huge round of applause to our mayor of Gresham, Shane Bemis, the best mayor in the area. I am so sorry. I'm so good about that. I must be nervous. All right, and we have some amazing board members with us, and the amazing board member is the fact that they are our board members here. But before I do that, do we have any other elected officials? I know we have some city council members here. Would you please be acknowledged? You stand and be acknowledged. We have Kathy and John Harser from Gresham Barlow. Is there anybody else, elected school board member here? We appreciate the participation from our school board members. Local school boards are very important. They're rocks. Okay, our amazing board members. I'm going to have them stand as well. Our president, who is with Warren Allen Law Firm, Warner Allen. Thank you for coming today, President Allen. Our newest board member from Adventist Medical Center, Lori Aoki. Hi, Lori. Thanks for being here. Matt Miller, I want you to stand because I want everybody to see how well you're dressed today. From Gresham Sanitary. There we go. Thank you. No, he's going to play a round of golf after he's done today, so he dressed appropriately. Frontier Communications is represented on our board by Andrew Morrison. Andrew, thank you. Legacy Mounted Medical, Julie Reed. Julie, there you are. Hi. Thank you for being here. I've already introduced Athena once, but I'm going to introduce our board member from Gresham Barlow, Athena Vadnais. Athena, hi. And last but not least, John Maloney again. Hi, John. Stand up, please. He's for our board member from Portland General Electric. It's with great pleasure that I introduce the new chair of our Government Affairs Council and president of PDC Construction, and his offices are right downstairs in this building. What a great place to come to work. I'd like to introduce Brian Lessler to the podium. Brian?
Thank you very much, Lynn. Oh, we have to adjust that. There we go. Thank you very much, Lynn. It's great to see this kind of a turnout. It is really going to be an interesting political period over the next year, and I think it's so appropriate and wonderful that we have a veteran of that process and of our government in Senator Bob Packwood here to give us some perspectives on the things that are going on in Washington, D.C. today. Senator Bob Packwood was our Oregon State Senator from 1969 to 1995. Many in this room might be a little foggy remembering those days, so let me remind us of some of the accomplishments of our great Senator Packwood. In 1968, Bob Packwood defeated then-incumbent Wayne Morris after four terms in office. No one thought that Morris would lose, but yes, Packwood won against all odds. His skills were quickly noticed and appreciated. Most notably was his rise to the chairmanship of the powerful Senate Finance Committee. But even the political wonks who do remember those days may not know the leadership he displayed in the U.S. Senate in so many different areas and against all odds. He was the principal author of the 1986 tax reform bill. In 1986, Congress passed and the President signed the most sweeping tax reform bill in the history of the tax code. Henrik Smith, Pulitzer Prize winner, reported for the New York Times, said of Bob, in the Senate in 1986, Reagan's bill, the Tax Reform Act of 1986, was literally saved by the ingenuity and astonishing legislative skills of Bob Packwood of Oregon, Senate Finance Committee Chairman, against all odds. In a feat that actually has not been repeated in the last 30 years. He almost single-handedly deregulated the trucking industry against the opposition of both the Teamsters and the American Trucking Association. Dorothy Robine, author of Breaking the Special Interest, Trucking Deregulation, said the history of the deregulation of trucking industry was simply, without Bob Packwood, it would not have happened. Tax and trucking legislation was for the entire U.S. But he never stopped fighting for Oregon as well. He stopped the building of dams in Hell's Canyon. Hell's Canyon is on the Snake River between Oregon and Idaho. It is the deepest gorge in the U.S., deeper than the Grand Canyon. Democrats wanted to build a high federal dam like Hoover Dam. Republicans wanted Idaho Power to build three low head dams. And there was actually no support for a position of no dam at all. When Bob started the battle to save the river from the dam, not a single member of Congress from Oregon, Washington, or Idaho, Republican or Democrat, House or Senate, would support him. But the dams were stopped against all odds. The next time you drive down on I-84 and up the gorge, thank Bob Packwood. Early in the process, he championed the National Scenic Area Act when many of his colleagues were hesitant. Later on, he refused to support compromises that others were willing to entertain. Whenever you have a controversial legislation, you need someone to draw a line and say, "Don't cross this or you lose my support." Bob Packwood played that role, and all of us who appreciate the unspoiled spectacular vistas of the Columbia Gorge owe Senator Packwood an enormous debt of gratitude. As a side note, I just took some visitors from the state of California up to Crown Point this weekend over the 4th. We just missed the parade through Corbett by about 3 minutes. So we did get there, and it was a beautiful, picture-perfect day. It was astounding. They were blown away. I couldn't drag them off of the place. So it was thank you for that legacy and something that we can be proud to show guests here all the time. And against all odds, a rising star in his youth, native Oregonian, born in Portland, graduate of Grant High School, Willamette University, great-grandson of William Packwood, youngest member of the Oregon Constitutional Convention of 1897. Bob was the youngest party chairman of a major metropolitan area in the country. He was the youngest member of the Oregon State Legislature in 1962. He replaced Senator Ted Kennedy as the youngest senator after beating Wayne Morris. His debating and legislative skills could kill bills as well as pass them. His masterful floor management has been credited with derailing President Clinton's 1993 health care bill. Bob Packwood can still be found in Washington, D.C. He founded the lobbying firm Sunrise Research Corporation, representing clients like Northwest Airlines, Freightliner, and Marriott International. Please welcome someone who has been and continues to be successful against all odds. It's my pleasure to introduce Senator Bob Packwood.
As we were talking, he says, has politics gotten worse or meaner? And I said, yes, but it's understandable. I want you to think of Oregon. When I first ran, oh, wait a minute, I didn't introduce my wife. Lynn, that's your fault. This is my wife, Elaine Franklin, who is an old, stand up, Elaine, so that everybody can see you. Elaine runs political campaigns, and when Lynn was in the legislature, she and Elaine were literally married to each other on political campaigns throughout the state. Now, way before Lynn ever even got involved in politics, when I first ran for the legislature half a century ago, 98% of the voters were Republican or Democrat. You had moderating influences in both parties. Today, about one-third of the voters are not Republican or Democrat. They're independent, or they're green, or they're whatever, but they're not Republicans or Democrats, and they're not allowed to vote in the primary. So who does that leave in both parties to nominate candidates? It leaves the wings of both parties. And you get zealots from both parties, and zealots know they're right. They just know they're right. And to make a compromise is making a pact with the devil. And this same thing has happened in any number of other states in the United States. So you now have a Congress that is more partisanly divided, partially because of the electoral process that drives out the middle of both parties because they're not allowed to vote. So that's part of the background. But is there still fun in politics? Oh, yes, there's great fun. Elaine, my wife, was my chief of staff for 15 years, and we would be on the road in different places or functions. One of the ones I remember most of all is Grants Pass. Evening function, I'm speaking to maybe 150 people in the city council chambers, but before I'm to speak, they're making a wonderful award to a woman about 75, I would say, of everything she had done in the community, the Boys and Girls Aid Society, the school district, didn't matter what it is. And it was so poignantly done. A person on the city, one of the city council or somebody else, would say something, put a rose in a vase and pass it on to the next person. They'd put a rose in and say everything she had done. And at the end of it, you wondered how on earth did she ever do this? For the first 20 years of her marriage, she didn't have a telephone. She had to go to the local grocery store and use their telephone. She was sensational. So she gets up and she says, well, I've been so lucky to be able to do this for the community. I could not have done it, though, without my husband, Charles. And Charles, I wonder if you would say something. Charles get up and said, I'll tell you one thing, she don't dust. Or there are unusual friendships in politics. One of my closest personal friends was Lane Kirkland, the national president of the AFL-CIO. As a young lawyer, I'd practiced a little bit of labor law and at least understood the issue. But in life, you meet people that you just fit. And Lane and I and our wives fit perfectly. We would go to the theater together. We'd go to movies together. We'd have dinner together, just the four of us. And in 1980, I was running for re-election against Ted Kulongoski, subsequently our governor. He was then a midterm senator from Lane County. So win or lose, he'd still be in the legislature. He had represented the AFL-CIO, the Lane County Labor Central Committee. I was trying to get labor to be neutral. I knew I had no hope of getting an endorsement. But I wonder if I could get them to be neutral. Well, I didn't succeed. They endorsed Kulongoski, the Oregon labor did. So I call Lane Kirkland. He was in Vienna, Switzerland, at the International Labor Organization. I said, oh, Lane, you know, darn it, they have endorsed my opponent. And he goes, well, I guess we'll just have to make sure the unions give them 5,000, give them 500. And I actually raised more labor money than Kulongoski did. Not that I raised much. He would just cut off. This is what friendship means. But another wonderful experience with Lane. My wife and I are going to a dinner party at Howard Baker's house of major Republican donors. And we pull up and park in front of the house, and Lane pulls up and parks right in front of us. And as we walk into the house, he walks in with us, and he asks where the bar is, and downstairs. He goes downstairs. I said, I'm going to stay up here, Lane, and meet people as they come in the door. About 2 minutes later, he comes back up. He says, where the hell am I? And I said, well, this is Republican Senatorial Committee fundraiser, Lane. Where's your check? And he said, my God, isn't this the German ambassador's home? And I said, no, no, no. The ambassador's home was next door. He saw my wife and I get out of the car, and he assumed we're going to the same place, and he follows us in. And then Margaret Thatcher. First, to appreciate this, you have to understand what Gibraltar is. It is not just a rock or the Rock of Gibraltar or the rock you see in ads. It is a principle of British naval base and has been for 300 years. Britain got it from Spain in 1707 under a treaty. Spain had lost a war, and they got it. And it's actually, you know, it abuts the Spanish mainland. But in a main, British still is, a main British repair base, naval base. Well, Elaine and I are at a dinner one night at the British Embassy, and it's in honor of Margaret Thatcher, and the British ambassador is the host of it. So at the end of dinner, it's his turn first to make the toast, and he said, Prime Minister, you may not remember when we first met. You were not then Prime Minister, you were the Conservative Party leader, and you and your husband, Dennis, came to Spain. And we had a good, hard government-to-government day of work. And then that evening, you and Dennis, my wife and I, and the Spanish Foreign Secretary and his wife went out to dinner in that delightful little restaurant up on the hill. And when you left, you wrote in the guest book, Gibraltar is British. But she said, I was able, by dint of diplomacy, to keep the Spanish Foreign Secretary from seeing what you wrote. And she responded, she went, oh, Tony, his name was Anthony Ackland. Oh, Tony, she says, you're such a wonderful boy. She said, I didn't care if the Spanish Foreign Secretary saw that I had written Gibraltar is British. The Spanish know that Gibraltar is British. It's the British Foreign Service that forgets from time to time. So, see, there's wonderful humor in politics. Let's talk today about just two things, tax reform and spending. Tax reform is easy in theory, although I discovered I always had to be careful when somebody in the audience said, I want a flat tax. And I'd say, what do you mean by that? 10% tax and I get to keep all my deductions. I said, no, that isn't what a flat tax is. A flat tax is you lose all your deductions and you can dramatically lower the rates. Well, he's not sure of that. He never thought of it that way. Indeed, at least when I was chairman of the Finance Committee a generation ago, you could have had a flat tax if you got rid of all exemptions, all deductions, and counted everything as income. It's not now counted. Interest on municipal bonds, fringe benefits that your employer provides. If you did all that, you could have a flat tax at around 11%. Now, that would mean, however, that the widow of two kids who pays no taxes now would pay $1,100. So people say, well, that isn't fair. So if you allowed all families of four have a $30,000 exemption, again, this is 25, 30 years ago, you could still have a flat tax around 19%. And you'd have to skew it just a bit. The flat tax, very slightly, not a lot, but only slightly favors the rich, mainly because the very rich who have all of these deductions would lose them all. The guy working in the mill that fires a 1040 EZ doesn't really have a lot of deductions to lose anyway. But that's what you would have to do. But here's what you run up against if you're going to try to have tax reform and get rid of deductions. You had better do it on a big scale, because if you try to do this, you know, if we eliminate the mortgage interest deduction, why, we can lower the tax rate 3%, top half, and 39% to 36%. And you will immediately draw the fierce opposition of the home builders, carpenters union, mortgage bankers, realtors. To them, they are as passionate about that issue as right to life is about abortion or the NRA is about guns. They will bring absolute total pressure on a member to vote against that kind of a reform bill. And there is not any generic welling up of ground support for tax reform. It just isn't there. So the only way you're going to do it is if you really say, okay, no more charitable deductions, no more mortgage interest deductions, taxation on municipal bonds, fringe benefits will be taxed. You could do it in that fashion, but you'll never do it piecemeal, one issue at a time, because you will draw the opposition, ferocious opposition of whatever the group is. But if somehow you've taken on 7 or 8 groups and have lowered the tax rates by 20%, you suddenly have a different constituency. But that's the only way you will get tax reform done. Now, spending. Spending's easy. I regard spending as a much greater problem than the debt. We can finance the debt. It's not unlike a mortgage on your house. You know, you make $100,000, you can afford a $200,000 house. You make $1 million, you can afford a $2 million house, and you can afford to carry the mortgage. We can actually afford to carry the debt. We're paying an immense amount of interest, but can we afford it? Yes. The problem is the projections on spending in the future. If you took nothing but Medicare, Medicaid, Social Security, and then other government retirement, military retirement, civilian, federal civilian employees, and interest on the debt, they will be about 70% within a decade, 70% of the entire federal budget. That means that infrastructure gets squeezed, education gets squeezed, environmental protection gets squeezed, unless you want to dramatically increase taxes to take care of that, and most people don't want that. But here is the inevitable history. A century ago, all of the governments in the United States, federal, state, local, fire districts, water districts, anything, spent about 9% to 10% of the gross domestic product altogether. Today, all the same governments spend about 41 or 2%. And over those 100 years, it has been this. You know, does it dip on occasion? Yes. But is that the trend? And really, the debate ought to be, what is this, not the size of the deficit, but how much of the gross domestic product does this country want to spend on government? And local government is about a third of that total spending. Don't assume it's all federal. How much? Whether or not you can make that debate, I don't know. And we're obviously going into Obamacare now. It's not going to be repealed. Every medical program we have ever undertaken, especially Medicare and Medicaid, we have underestimated the cost of it year by year by year. Every time we underestimate it, I think we probably will on Obamacare. But will we get rid of it? No. Will, as we have with Medicare, since it was adopted in the mid-60s, tinker with it? Yes. Have we tinkered with it sufficiently that we have narrowed the cost or at least stopped the increase? No. But unless America finally says, you know, we don't really want to look like Denmark or Sweden, spending 52, 53, 55% of their gross domestic product, we don't want to do that. That is the debate we ought to be having. And within that debate, how do you want to allocate the resources that we are going to spend? Do you want it to be disproportionate on health and pensions? Or do you want to spread it under a bigger variety of different things and maybe have to narrow, and you want to phrase this very carefully if you're in politics, how to narrow the increase in spending on health and pensions. You never say, I want to cut it. And you want to be careful of this. If the president's budget wants to increase something 10% and Congress increases it 5% from what we're spending, they will be accused of having cut spending by 5%, even though it's up 5%. So as a politician, you just want to be careful of how you choose your words, and you think to yourself, how can they be taken out of context? God, it was so much easier in my day with no cell phones and none of those instant cameras. And if somebody really would have to have been in the room consciously listening to what you're saying, not just picking up something accidentally across a table when you're conversing. Anyway, that's it. That's politics then and now. Appreciate being here. Be happy to take any questions.
they didn't want that to come out of there. That was really entertaining and very insightful. We'll have a few questions for the good of the order, and then we'll open it up to you if you have some questions you'd like to ask Senator Packwood. Senator, one of the questions in this 2016 presidential race, it appears that we have one party with an heir apparent to the nomination and another party with enough candidates to field a football team. What are the political implications for each party, and is there an inside the Beltline favorite in the Republican camp, insofar as you know?
No, there is no favorite inside. This is not like the time Bob Dole ran for it or John McCain ran for it. They were kind of favorites, but nobody in this race comes out at 5-4 and everybody else is 10-1. So you can pay your money and take your choice on this. I have a bet with my wife Elaine, however, that Hillary will not be the Democratic nominee. And if that is not the case, it will be a very interesting race. Now, the problem, in my judgment, a lot of Republican candidates have is they have to tilt so far to the right in the primaries that they're stuck with the statements that they have made in the general election, and it kills them. Jeb Bush is trying to avoid that. At the moment, he has attempted to moderate his tone, realizing that he has to compete, but certainly not making statements like Ted Cruz or others. I mean, here's an example of foolishness. Before the Supreme Court made the decision on gay marriage, 32 states had already legalized gay marriage. This really wasn't a decision that upset the established order. Had the court done nothing, and there's people that wish they had, I would think in another 5 to 10 years, all but 2 or 3 states in the union would have had gay marriage. But now to say, my policy is going to be, if I'm elected, I'm going to support a constitutional amendment to reverse the decision. That's just foolish. This is not going to happen. Don't waste your time on it. Don't waste your breath. But for heaven's sakes, if you are going to keep saying that so that you win the Iowa caucus, you are dead in the general election. And there is no Republican favorite, and we'll see how Elaine's and my bet comes out.
Another question, Senator, is much is written today about the disregard or even the erasing of the checks and balances that were designed into our governmental structure between the legislative, judicial, and executive branches. What are your thoughts today on that issue and the effectiveness of our federal governance?
Well, there's no question, starting roughly with the New Deal onward, incredible quantities of power have flowed to the president, to the executive branch. In most cases, however, because of actions that Congress has taken to give him the power. And of course, it's an ideal thing for a member of Congress. The president does something you don't like. Had I been president, I wouldn't have allowed that. He doesn't bother to say, but I did vote to give him that power. It is still hard. I mean, you know, there are things a president can do that you question as to whether it's legal or not. But most of his powers flow from Congress. Example, in almost any criminal case in a county, the district attorney has a lot of what they call prosecutorial discretion. What kind of case is, you know, he's only got limited manpower. Is he going to spend a lot of time on traffic offenses? Is he going to spend a lot of time on minor things that he thinks is minor? He just isn't going to pursue those. And, of course, the FBI does the same. They have limited money. They can't investigate every conceivable kind of federal, that's a federal crime. They just can't. Does the president, therefore, and, of course, the president is the chief prosecutor in the country, he's head of the Justice Department as president, does he have the legal right to say to the Department of Justice, exercising my prosecutorial powers, I choose not to pursue illegal immigrants? Does that violate the law or not? My guess is it does not. Any more than he would say, henceforth, we're not going to chase bank robbers. They're not a big issue anymore. Get rid of your bank robber force and turn it over to something else. So I'm inclined, before I start criticizing him, to think to myself, one, is it legal? I think it is. Two, do I think it's wise? No, I don't think so. But again, I get a little upset with people that pound the table and say he's acting illegally. And then when you ask them, what has he done that is illegal, they really don't have an answer. What else you got there?
Given the amount of money being spent on even local, nonpartisan campaigns, to say nothing of state and national campaigns, what ideas might you suggest in terms of campaign reform to improve the process and the outcomes?
Lynn will find this hard to believe. When I first ran for the legislature in 1962, Lynn, my primary cost $1,300, my general election $1,900. Today, you can just make that thousands instead of what it was. At the moment, there's not much you can do. The Supreme Court's decision in Citizens United has basically said almost that any amount of money can be raised spent on politics. There are limitations in theory, 501c3s and 501c4s, which are either charitable or social welfare organizations, are not supposed to spend their money on politics. But let's say candidate Jones is running for Congress against Congressman Smith. And without saying vote for Smith or vote for Jones, a group runs ads, Congressman Smith, in our judgment, has made a mistake in voting for this. Congress doesn't say vote for him, vote against him. It is educational. It's almost unlimited in what they can do. I don't see with the Supreme Court decision on Citizens United that you're going to see any restraint in politics. But I have discovered this. For a number of years in the 60s, I was retained to recruit candidates to run for the legislature. And then for 4 years, I was chairman of the Republican Senatorial Campaign Committee and recruited people to run for the Senate. I don't know how they do it, but I have discovered if a candidate is believed to have a reasonable chance of winning, the money can be raised. Somehow, it's amounts that boggle my mind. But if you get to Labor Day and you're running against an incumbent, and 6 months earlier you were behind 55-31, and now you're only behind 51-43, the money will be raised for that race. I have no idea how you do it, because when I was in the Senate, the amounts were so minuscule in comparison to what you see now.
Are there questions from the floor that anyone would like to ask Senator?
Can we switch to international events?
Sure. You mean the soccer game?
Yes, USA. That was great. You know, they had more audience than football, basketball, all combined. It's amazing. But the question is, I noticed that ISIS is recruiting lots of young people into their fold, and that's a great international threat. And U.S. is not doing much to really trim their power. What would you suggest we can do with that group?
We are going to, I don't know what you do internally with ISIS. I don't know, again, remember I talked about zealots. I don't know, excuse me, I don't know what you do about zealots that really blow themselves up on their way to heaven. So internally, I don't know what you do. And I can understand a handful of people around the world of the Muslim religion being attracted to that and leaving the U.S. or leaving Britain or leaving wherever they are, and they want to go participate. The fundamental question in what I would call the Western civilized countries is, how much do we have to give up in terms of personal liberty, in terms of surveillance, in terms, frankly, of undercover agents to attempt to ferret them out before they get out of this country or something? And it's an interesting battle. And you saw the battle that has just gone on in terms of the federal government's right to listen on your phone calls. They really weren't listening. What they were doing, simply keeping track of who you were calling. And if they finally discovered that you had called Yemen 33 times in the last 60 days and you'd had phone calls back from Yemen, they're inclined to put you on the watch list. And just multiply that 10 times over and then think to yourself, which is the greater risk? Is the power of the federal government, especially, but the power of any government, to falsely accuse, falsely imprison, falsely bring cases against people they think are a problem, is overwhelming. You don't want to be, unless you're a multi-millionaire, on the side of having to defend yourself against the federal government on some charge. That's why so many people plead guilty. They cannot afford to fight it, and they get some kind of a plea deal with the prosecutor. But I don't know the answer. The one thing I hope we do, and we're doing pretty well on fracking, there's no reason we can't be independent in oil and gas easily within the next decade, and especially counting the resources of Mexico and Canada. And whether or not we want to say, you know, that's it, we're getting out of the Middle East, and it's no longer our problem. They'll have to sort it out. They've been fighting religiously for years, not much we can do about it. We'll just pull out and let them have at it. And interestingly, that is what happened in Europe in the 30 Years' War that ended in 1648. Up until that time, it had been tremendous religious wars. It was mainly Southern Europe Catholic against the Northern European newly come along Protestant religions. And that 30 Years' War, 18 to 48, was savage. As savage as anything you're seeing ISIS do now. And finally, at the Treaty of Westphalia in 1648, the European powers said, we're not going to go to war anymore over religion. How you may prosecute somebody in your country is one thing, but we're not going to go to war with each other over religion. And by and large, even though we've had wars, innumerable wars since that time, they have not been religious wars. Yeah.
So, Senator, you were in the Congress in 1993, and so far as I know, that was the last time that there was a increase in the federal gas tax. I was driving up here today, and I was listening to the CEO of Skanska USA talking about the crumbling infrastructure in the United States. The state of Oregon couldn't even pass a $300 million transportation bill. And the federal government's, the federal highway fund is essentially broke. Is there a formula for realizing we need to fix this infrastructure, a political formula for fixing that problem?
There's no formula at the moment. And remember what I said about earlier about where we're spending more and more of our money? There's an element in Congress that says no more taxes. If you want to increase spending on infrastructure, we're going to take it out of something else. And the something else you want to take it out of has absolutely zealous supporters that don't want anything taken out of that program. And so long as you have no more taxes, I can understand that. In the past, taxes lead to more spending, if that's what you want. Now, having said that, my hunch is you're going to get, in the next 2 to 3 years, an increase in both at the federal level and the state level in the gas tax, because the infrastructure is so bad. But it's going to be overwhelming opposition about, by golly, I want this not only spent on infrastructure, I want to see cuts in other areas that equal what we're going to increase on infrastructure.
Other questions? Come on, don't be bashful. Let me get this gentleman, I'll get right back to you. Well, the order of the president wants to speak.
Senator, could you comment a little bit on what you see will be happening, especially to the European Union, with the Greece thing, if Greece actually
My hunch
tumbles.
Is Greece is going to win temporarily. That the tug to hold the Union together will be so great that there will be another bailout of Greece. And Greece will make promises to do things. Whether they won't do them, whether they get the money and still don't do them, and 6 months from now, Greece comes back and has another vote, we want out. we won't take this anymore. I don't know. Sometimes I think to myself, I'm hardly involved in European Union matters, but I keep thinking to myself, what difference does it make if Greece drops out? They're not a significant worldwide economic figure. They're not a significant inter-European figure. But everybody seems to feel that's the dropping shoe. Britain's going to have a vote in 2017 on should they withdraw from the Union. My hunch is they will vote no, but it will be a ferocious battle. And we saw the stories in the paper today of both the fringe left and the fringe right cheering at Greece's vote. It's sort of as if the European Union is a bureaucracy shoving their views down on us. And I don't know what will happen, but I think they will be bailed out temporarily for a modest period of time in exchange for promises.
Senator Packwood, recently Vice President Biden said that the Republican Party is not the same as when you were in it. I was wondering if you agree with that statement, and if you do, how would you suggest that they get back to it?
The Republican Party is much more conservative, and especially on the social issues, than when I was there. And part of it is the Republican Party is now heavily influenced by the South. A disproportionate number of the House members are from the South. And a social policy in Alabama just probably is not Oregon's social policy. And yet it is held up as the Republican policy. I'll give you an example in this state on abortion. Over the past quarter of a century, we have had five different abortion votes. In each case, the pro-life force has lost. Two of the votes were on parental notification. And you think, well, that would be one of the easiest ones. Not only did they lose, they lost on the second vote bigger than the first time. Well, you put that on the ballot in Alabama, it'll pass 2-1. I remember Barry Goldwater was one of Barry Goldwater hated platforms. He says, why can't our platform just be the Republican Party will defend the shores and deliver the mail? And that's it. And let every candidate in every state interpret that as he wants instead of trying to saddle us with something that might work in some states and doesn't work in others. Having said that, the party is much more conservative than it was when I went there. And part of it is just how candidates are now selected in terms of zealots rather than centrists.
How do you recommend that they get back there, if you don't mind me asking a follow-up question? Or to a place?
Well, here's where I always have hope, but it isn't working out. Sooner or later, if you continue to lose elections, a party would rather win than lose. And if they keep losing elections over the same issues, they'll change. But as a matter of fact, they're doing sensationally in races for Congress and the Senate. So they're buying clients. Why should we change? The public is with us. Although, you've got to separate the public. In 2010, the Republicans had their first big sweep. It's when they took over the House of Representatives. It's gotten bigger and bigger since then. But on each of those elections, 2010, 2012, 2014, the Republicans did not defeat a single Democratic incumbent west of the Sierra Nevadas or the Cascades. It tells you something about the makeup of Oregon, Washington, and California once you get west of the mountains. Well, I'll just say it. If a candidate in this state was anti-gay marriage, anti-choice on abortion, I think they would have a very difficult time winning a statewide race. I think you could win it easily in Alabama. So why don't we let Oregon do what we want and Alabama do what it wants, and neither the twain shall meet, probably.
Other questions?
Okay, over the past several years, there's been a lot of talk about the rich and how they should be taxed. If there was some program that taxed the wealthy, and I don't consider $250,000 wealthy. And that seems to be the cutoff always discussed. Well, we're not going to touch, you know, the 250,000 below, okay? But when you're talking about the upper echelon, half a million, million, and beyond, would it make a significant difference if there was some tax legislation in that direction only and raise that from the 250 to 500 or a million? Because, frankly, it really hurts the middle class, which I consider under 250,000.
If you really want to, if you really want to hit them, don't think about the income tax. Think about a wealth tax, which is sort of like a property tax. That's a wealth tax. How much is your property worth? You pay more. If you've got all these wealthy people that have scores of billions that they've made one way or another, and have paid taxes on it at some stage, they no longer pay taxes on that unless they sell something and have capital gains. If you really want to hit the rich, that's the way to do it. But here's the downside. I don't mind hitting the rich, however you want to define it. It is not going to solve our spending problems. It may make you feel better, but it is not going to solve the spending problems this government faces. One time, I had the Joint Tax Committee, which is a professional group that is hired by Congress to help us on tax estimates. And I once asked them how much money we could raise if we confiscated all of the income above $200,000. We'll just take it all. This is, again, 30 years ago, and that was a lot of money then. Well, they did a little study, and they came back to me and said the first year we would expect we'd get $60 billion more, and then the second year we'd get $80 billion more, and they had a five-year estimate going up each year. So I called up the head of it. I said, I want to get something straight here. You're saying if we confiscate all of their income, that our revenues will continue to grow. He says, well, we presume no change in behavior. And I said, really, taxing the rich heavily will not solve our spending problems. Whether you want to do it, it looks like Britain maybe about to do it on how much can you make as a bank president. The banks are especially vulnerable. But it simply will not solve our problems. And I've seen these figures. You know, 50 years ago, the president of General Motors made 20 times as much as his employee, and now it's 200 times as much, or whatever the figure may be. Just disproportionately large. But the only way, if you really, really wanted to do it, would have to be a wealth tax, not an income tax.
Other questions? We have a couple of more minutes. Yes. Legacy.
Thank you. Your statement earlier about underestimating the cost of Medicare, have you thought about how we're underestimating the cost of Obamacare?
Oh,
because
yes.
That statement really scares me.
Oh, yes. I think there's no, you know, this is just based upon experience. I saw the figures when Medicare and Medicaid were passed in 1965. The estimates it would cost in 1970, 1980, 1990. We were off by hundreds of percent, and we will be off on Obamacare. But for better or for worse, we're into it. And it is not, you know, certainly isn't going to be repealed with this president. And assuming you had a Republican president and a Republican Congress, and you were to repeal it, you're now going to have, spread throughout the state, 10 to 15 million people that are on this medical subsidy. And they're going to be as much of a firebrand about that subject as realtors will be about reducing the mortgage deduction. So we will tinker with it. We've tinkered with Medicaid for the last 50 years. We've tinkered with it, in each case hoping somehow to restrain its growth. We just haven't succeeded.
Do you have any suggestions on how we might be able to prepare for if the prediction is true and Obamacare follows?
Well, here is one. I think you'll see this coming on Medicaid. I think within a decade, almost all Medicaid will be basically contracted care. The federal government will no longer pay a doctor $100. It will be basically a health maintenance organization. And the way you pay them, you say, okay. And Medicaid is a federal, state, and local. Okay. We will give you $200 a month per person covered in your plan. You have got to live with that. Now, you have to take anybody that's pre-existing illness, doesn't count. And on occasion, I've talked to these organizations where they really get hit. They said, okay, $200, this is just an example, $200. And then you have a flu outbreak, and they just get killed with people coming in for, you know, taking care of flu. But somehow they make it. They don't have great profits, but they make it. And I think you're going to see all of Medicaid in that, and it will be compulsory. That will save money in this sense for the government. The government knows what it's going to cost them. We're going to pay you $200 a patient. You can count on that. The only reason that's going to go up is if they have more patients. So that, and the government likes the idea of at least being able to figure what it is. You know, I used to discover this years ago in politics. Business complained to me more about environment and regulations than they complained about taxes. The taxes, at least, they knew what they were. But regulation, had no way to plan for it.
I thought maybe you might comment a little bit about in the last year or so we're reading about China, and China is this economic drive to be then the powerhouse in the world, and the whole goal is to minimize then United States as being a leader economically. I thought maybe you might comment your perspective on that.
Well, every country in the world wants to be an economic power. Every country in the world wants to be a leader. Most of them, and smaller countries, can be niche leaders. Switzerland can be a niche leader in hiding money. Sweden makes Volvos. I think it's Sweden where they were made there. But the major powers, they want to be major powers. And we've had this head-to-head power struggle for years. Winston Churchill used to say, what has been the English policy in Europe over the centuries? To oppose whoever the most powerful force was on the continent. If that was France, we allied with Germany. If that was Germany, we allied with France. And we're going to go head-to-head with China. The one interesting thing about China, as opposed to most dictatorships, unless you want to argue about Tibet, which they've always thought was part of China, and Taiwan, which they've always thought about was part of China, they have not been a particularly imperialistic power. I'll tell the story, then I'll say. This is 1978. I'm visiting China with a congressional delegation led by then Senator Ed Muskie from Maine. And we are not yet recognizing China. Nixon had been there, but we're still recognizing Taiwan as the government of China. But there we are, a congressional visit. We're there about 2 weeks. Every place we went, the issue was Taiwan. We want Taiwan back. It belongs to us. We could be 1,500 miles inland at a duck farm, and the farmer who's never seen the ocean has never heard of Taiwan. Taiwan is ours. So every place we went. On the last night we're there, there's a goodbye banquet, and Ed Muskie spoke first, the Chinese foreign secretary. I keep thinking, you know, we don't recognize this country, but the Chinese foreign secretary is putting on this goodbye banquet for us. Ed is about 6'4". The Chinese foreign minister is maybe 5'7". And Ed is standing, making the toast. So here he's standing up. Here's the Chinese foreign minister down here. And he goes, Mr. Secretary, I want to thank you so much. It's been a most informative trip. He goes, oh, but I said, I want to tell you one thing. We are going to, and Ed had several drinks at this stage. We are going to support Taiwan economically, militarily, socially, in every way. Why? You would not get Taiwan for 50 years. The foreign minister who speaks English looks up, goes, 50 years? Well, we can start the bargain tonight. And, you know, they waited 50 years and they got Hong Kong. We're a wonderful engineering nation. Put a man on the moon this decade, we do it. We don't have patience. You can see this in long wars. We don't have patience for long wars. Why can't we end this thing now? It only took us 3.5 years in World War II. Britain would say it took, as Elaine is English, he would say it took a bit longer than the 3.5. But England having been in it 2.5 years before we got in it. But, you know, we're going to have, I will give Nixon credit for basically opening up China. In fact, there's an inside story as to how it was done. Henry Kissinger went there ahead of time several times, but no one knew he was doing it and the way he did it. He went to Pakistan and he flew commercially on a Pakistani airline to China. And for whatever reason, nobody picked it up. And so he was there making the arrangements. And, you know, it's like Cuba. We can't ignore Cuba. It's there. We can't ignore China. It's there. They're going to be there. So you make the best of the situation. But is there any way we can attempt to stop them from wanting to grow? No. Can we stop them? Do we know legally how to stop them, or physically, from hacking our computer systems? And the only reason I pause there is I'm sure we're doing the same thing. I'd be surprised if, in fact, I'd be surprised, frankly, if we weren't ahead of them in that business, but of course we don't talk about that. You may recall about 2 years ago, the Iranians had a terrible time with their centrifuges flying apart. And well, what had happened, there was a bug called Sextant. It had been invented by the Israelis with our support, and it inserted itself in their computer system, basically left an egg to do the damage and disappeared so that you had no way to trace where it came from. And it absolutely wrecked their centrifuges and set them back several years in what they were doing. My hunch is we probably have a few more rabbits like that also in our hat.
We have time for one more question.
I have another speech. I mean...
Thank you.
Senator Packwood, this gets back to current Congress right now. It used to be that the Speaker of the House and the Senate President had absolute power, and now it seems that they're there as figureheads, and if they don't want to follow Speaker Boehner or President, I call him Uncle Minchie, but I know he's got a different name. McConnell. That seems to me a big change.
You mean the power of the leadership?
The power of the leadership. It seems like it's just not there.
When I went to the Senate, seniority was absolutely sacrosanct. You did not touch it. Lyndon Johnson did not touch it. You were there long enough, you got to be a committee chairman. And, you know, let hell or high water come, you weren't going to change your position for Lyndon Johnson or anybody else. Gradually, that system has changed. And everybody says, well, that's a good idea. You trade it. Now, in both the House and the Senate, the leader can make appointments to some of these committees or can advance people to chairman that are not senior. Well, who does that make that person beholden to other than the leader who has appointed him? When the seniority days, the leader didn't have that power. In addition to that, which has weakened the committee structure, both the House, and this happened starting with Newt Gingrich in the House, it's not new, but started with Newt, in both houses now, the power has accreted upward to the leadership. And if it continues, you're going to have a system not unlike the party structure in Britain, where you've got the prime minister in a cabal of 10 to 15 people, and the rest are basically backbenchers. The decisions are made by that little cabal. And that is happening. I don't like it. It is happening in the Congress.
Thank you so much today for sharing your time and your wisdom with us. It's been a pleasure to have you.
Thank you, Senator, and thank you for introducing Elaine. When I was 20 years old, I did something that was different to put myself through college, and I ran for Miss Oregon, and I won, and I was able to complete my college education which allowed me to be a teacher, which allowed me to meet my husband, and the rest is history. But one of my most coveted times during that year, which was an amazing year, was having lunch with Senator Packwood and in D.C. And the picture that I sent out earlier was that. And I'm only bringing this to your attention because you never know when paths cross how they will recross again. Never in a million years did I think for a minute that the highlight of my 20-year-old would be a friendship, not only with you, Senator, and a mutual respect, but of Elaine, too. And this is a perfect example of where people don't have to agree. You just have to trust each other. You have to trust each other to work hard. And you have the same goal eventually, but you don't have to agree with everything. And the hard work that you did in the Senate and that your wife does in campaigns is because people work for them because they trust them. You trust that the right thing is going to happen at the end. So thank you for that and for being such a big part of my life. And there aren't a whole lot of pictures in my house, believe me, of when I was that age. But this one I do covet. So anyway, all right, enough about me and back to why we're here. I want to thank Riverview so much for your sponsorship and Portland General Electric so much for being presenting sponsors for Metro East Community Media and for Gresham Barlow District. Next month, we actually have two forums. One is a joint forum with the West Columbia Gorge and EME. We're going to do a legislative wrap-up or sausage rolling. It depends on where you are on that, but we get to experience that. Our legislative leaders are going to be there, and we're going to host that jointly together. Watch the emails for the exact date. And for our regular forum here, we have two incredible women. Jean from Human Solutions and Betty from Home Forward are going to take the podium and talk to us about those. Now, in front of you are the evaluation sheets. I don't care how many words you put down on that, but please fill them out because we do read them, we do listen, and who knows, maybe Senator Packwell will come back again if you say nice things about him on those evaluation forms. So thank you again, Senator, and thank you again, Elaine, for coming today, and thank you all for coming, too. Appreciate you being here.